a steam locomotive and the Highlands of Scotland. Beautiful maybe, but both can be uncompromising and difficult, requiring a special kind of loyalty. By no means are the days always bright and sunny, nor are the engines without a similarly varied temperament as they yield their power from fire and water. For the authorities, back in the 1960s, there was one solution. Let the steam trains go. Then in the 1980s, they had an astonishing change of heart. Bring steam back again. Let people visit the Highlands in the old way. Encourage them to see spectacular scenery in a spectacular fashion. And let the drivers who had switched from steam be given the chance of switching back again. Men like Callum McCrailed, one of the special breed of West Highland railwaymen.
When I left school at 15, I certainly had no thoughts about the railway. I got a temporary job in the post office as a telegram boy. And at the end of the year, I was earning £2.2 and 6 a week. And my brother Neil, who was on the railway, he said, well, you'll get £3.5 as a cleaner. So immediately I changed my employment. And once I was on the railway, for a few months, there was no way I would ever leave it. It's something that just gets into your blood, and you just wouldn't think of any other job. There's no, some people did start and leave, but there was no way I would ever have left the railway. Coming from a family, as I did, of mostly railwaymen, my two grandfathers were on the railway. My father was on the railway. I had 8 uncles on the railway. And I have 2 brothers that were on the railway. One is now retired. So I think once I started, there was no way out of it. That was me. I was a railwayman. I didn't know it. I think you must be devoted to the railway. When you join the railway, you don't just go for 8 hours a day. You've got to be a railwayman. After that, you do other things. But the railway has the first call on you. And they know about that because they send for you any time it suits them. You just get a line, turn out all speed, and they expect you to come. And I think if you're a true railwayman, I think you'll be there.
Just about 3 weeks before our first baby was due, he was due to be home about 9 o'clock at night. And it came midnight, no word from him. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. He eventually came home at 3 o'clock in the morning to find an extremely anxious wife. He'd had to walk about 2 miles across Rannoch Moor to get help. The train had broken down, I think that time, in a snowdrift as well. And by the time he came home, I'm afraid I was in quite a state. And also very angry that nobody had told me about it.
Well, Helen usually knows when I'm away down the road, and I've no doubt she thinks about it and wonders how I'm getting on, you know, because it is a difficult job when there's snow. But she puts up with it and she doesn't complain. And she doesn't tell me she worries, but I've no doubt she is a wee bit bothered. I started in 1948, and of course it was all steam engines then. Nothing else. We didn't know what diesels were then. All hard work and dirt. But we didn't mind. It was a good type of work, you know, there was plenty of friendship among the boys, and although it was hard work, everyone got stuck in, and if someone had a sort of difficult job to do, his mates were there to help him, and we all helped each other.
Someone also getting stuck in on a difficult job in those days was the famous Dr. Beeching, who killed off railway lines almost as if he was on commission.
Dr. Beeching was just a name to us. He was doing damage down south, but he never quite reached our area, and we treated him like a sort of disease. If you can keep clear of it, you just leave him alone and hope that it won't affect you. Dr. Beeching, to my mind, was just a butcher. A 5-year-old could have done what Dr. Beeching did, because he just looked at a profit and loss account and he said, well, this line's paying and this one's not, so we'll cut it away. I think it was criminal. So that's about all I can say about Dr. Beeching.
So not only did the line from Fort William to Mallaig on the west coast survive, but surprisingly, so did an LNER engine actually designed for working the West Highlands. British Rail has to hire it from the enthusiasts who own it.
You know, I had fired steam engines for 15 years before the diesels came, and we had a lot more to do than we have now, because we very often came in off a job and disposed of our own engine, which meant pulling the fire or dropping the fire, coaling and watering it, cleaning ash pans, smoke boxes, that sort of thing. When you would clean the fire, you had to go down underneath the engine in a pit and clean the ash pan. Very often, the wind would just decide to change and you'd get all the white dust of the ash pan covering you just. And you'd come up then and you'd clean the smoke box, and that's black ash, and you would end up, you were black. And it was rather like the black and white minstrels, because one minute you were white, the next minute you were black. And at the end of the day, it was doubtful just what colour you'd end up. But then it all came off. A good wash and you were clean again. How are things today?
Oh, not so bad, apart from the weather.
Aye, well, I hope it clears up. When the engine comes up to Fort William, the owners send their representatives with it, who look after it. They're actually mechanical men. They're fitters or mechanics, and they maintain it. And when we come in at night, they dispose of it. They take the fire out of it and clean the ashpan, smoke box, and they check the engine over. Anything that's needing repaired is done by them. So we really have the nice part of it. We just step on and drive it, which is quite nice. Much better than the old days when we had everything to do. When you go out to work the steam engine, you're not just too sure of what's going to happen, because there's several factors that are unknown. You're not too sure what the coal's like. The engine might not be doing quite as well, say if the fire hasn't been cleaned properly, or if the ash pan is a wee bit dirty or something like that. There's one or two factors you're not sure about until you get going. It's just a case of doing everything you can as best you can and just watch for the results.
Where it gets going is from Fort William, past Glenfinnan, and up and over the hills to Arisaig and finally Mallaig, 560 miles from London and the port for Skye. Then it's back to Fort William again.
Fort William is more or less the end of the line. We're very remote from the Lake of Glasgow, which is just over 100 miles away. There are drawbacks, because if you need something special, say something for your electric cooker or something for your car, you just can't get it in Fort William. It's a wee bit better now. As the town grows, there are more outlets for these sort of things, but there's still a lot of things that you just can't get in Fort William and you have to send for them. But these are things you just have to put up with, because there's so many benefits that you just have to accept there are a few drawbacks as well.
Fort William may be a long way north of Glasgow, but the steam is an extra attraction for someone to photograph. And people do come from far and wide to get a breath of the past alongside modern times. But past and present mingle oddly on the line itself. Not only are there steam locos and diesel engines, but all the trains are controlled by radio rather than signals. Traffic control is at Banavie, first stop on the Mallaig line, and any airline pilot or flight controller might feel quite at home listening in to the radio chat on this particular runway.
Request to enter the system at Fort William Branch. Over.
2123, Railcon Banavie, roger, to enter the system at Fort William. Present hold, send, over.
Railcon Banavie, 2123, request a token from Fort William to Glenfinnan, over.
2123, Railcon Banavie. For a long section token, Fort William, Glenfinnan, present hold, receive, over.
Railcon Banavie, 2123, roger, out.
It's a nice feeling to feel that you have the power of this great monster at your fingertips. And when you open the throttle and hear the sharp beat of it, and you know that everything is perfect mechanically, there's a lovely sound of it, and you're controlling it. It's a nice feeling, just a nice feeling. I feel it's more a living thing than the diesel. The diesel is just, you just sit in it and open a lever, pull a handle and it goes. But the steam, the fact that you have to do everything to get the results, you feel it's more a living thing. It's a job to me, it's a job I'm doing, and I realise that it's quite a nice job, and I think most of the passengers would do my job for nothing. In fact, some of them might even pay to do it. Everyone in the steam train is enjoying themselves. We're in the habit of running trains in Fort William here, especially in the winter time, with very few passengers, and a lot of them complain about things, anything at all. The public are very critical of the railway, and I think sometimes unfairly, but all of a sudden, we have a steam train and there's something like 350 passengers on it, and everyone's enjoying it. And it's infectious, and we feel that too. We enjoy it too because they're enjoying it, and there's never a complaint. I would say without hesitation that the Mallaig line is the nicest line, I think, in Britain. It has to be. I've travelled fairly extensively in Europe, and I've never seen anything to compare. I've seen things that were different, and I've seen railways that were very nice, but the Mallaig to me is just out of this world. The beauty is just, you can't describe it. You'd have to see it to appreciate it.
Not only are there the Highlands and the lochs and the islands, but a great feeling of history, as at Glenfinnan, where Bonnie Prince Charlie raised his banner, and of the crofters being cleared from the land, and then of Scotland being discovered by tourists, by romantics, and by the railway.
It was a terrific engineering work. Sir Robert McAlpine was the engineer, and he must have been some man, because when you look at some of the work that's on the Mallaig line, they say it was one of the most expensive lines in Britain to build because of all the tunnels and rock cuttings. I think it was the most expensive line in Britain per mile. And then there's the like of Glenfinnan Viaduct, which is a masterpiece. They called Sir Robert McAlpine Concrete Bob, and it's no wonder, because he was one of the pioneers of concrete, and Glenfinnan Viaduct, I reckon, is a monument to his capability. Every season of the year is different. In fact, every week almost is slightly different. You get all the different types of lighting. And then, of course, throughout the year, you have the autumn with the lovely colours, lovely browns and auburns and all that. The heather turns beautiful colour. Mallaig line can be very nice in very wet weather as well as good weather. There's days I've gone to Mallaig when there was torrential rain and the streams and small rivers and that are just foaming, and there's something very, very beautiful about that as well as seeing it in good weather. Thank you. The K1 is a very nice wee engine, very strong wee engine. It was built for the Mallaig line, and the size of the wheel is just right for the Mallaig line. It's very powerful, and it's no bother to pull six carriages up there. When they came out first, they were absolutely lovely wee engines. And it's very nice to see one back again on the Mallaig Road.
Railcom Banavie 2123, I now have a blank display and request the Glenfinnan Arisaig token. Over.
2123, Railcom Banavie, roger. For a Glenfinnan.
Do you feel you're never on your own now? At one time, you could fail maybe in the middle of a moor and have several miles on either side that you had to walk. But with this system, no matter what happens, we can just radio the controller and within very short time, something's been done.
When we got married, and for years after we were first married, there was nothing else but steam trains up here, so I didn't really give them too much thought. But I did miss them when the diesels came in. We used to live at one time in a flat, and it overlooked the depot, the goods depot where Callum left from. And in the early hours of the morning, you used to hear the goods trains going out, and it was lovely. A clear, frosty night, you would hear the sounds of the engine going away for miles away. It was beautiful. Loved it.
If you were locked in a dark room and you smelt, you would know exactly what it was if you smelt a steam engine. The smell and the sound. There's a lovely sharp crack off them when they're in good form, you know. They're just lovely, lovely sound of them.
Just love the sound of it. Steam engines, I think, are much more beautiful to look at than a diesel engine. There's just something about it that's different. I think it's lovely to see them come back again.
I think of myself as a sort of practical chap, quite keen in mechanics and that sort of thing. And the steam engine, to me, is just a massive thing with hundreds of beautifully engineered parts. You could more or less take one of 100 parts home and polish it up and put it in your mantelpiece as an ornament, you know. Lovely movement. You can see it working. I think that's what appeals to small boys too. They can stand at the side and see the motion. You can see what it's doing. And I suppose if you explained it to even a child, they can understand how it works. It's very simple. When you think of the weight of a steam engine, you're talking about maybe 130 tons. And when you look at the side rods, connecting rods, even the wheels revolving with their balance blocks, there's massive amounts of weights revolving there, and the centrifugal force must be terrific, and everything must be balanced, because if anything was slightly out of true, it would rattle the engine to bits. Just it would shake it to bits. When you go over the hill at Glenfinnan, you see Loch Eilt stretched out in front of you, and it's must be 3 or 4 miles. Lovely little loch with islands in the middle of it, and with a reflection in the water, it's a beautiful sight. The West Highland Railway is certainly a one-off. I don't know of any other railway anything like the West Highland. I think the Highlander is a certain type of person, and things happen in the West Highland just automatically. It's often said that they wouldn't need a management in the West Highland because the men know the job and they come out and do the job, and if there's problems, very often they're sorted out before the management know of them by men who have just happened to be there and take the responsibility of sorting things out. I've heard it said that we do miracles every day in the West Highland, but the impossible takes a wee while longer. When I started at 16, we had to do 313 firing turns, I think it was, and then you were called a first-year fireman. your mate was a friend, and I think that was because you worked together, you were dependent on each other. The driver couldn't do anything without the fireman's help. You know, they had to fight this sort of great monster between them, and they only got results according to how they worked. So I think there was more of a friendship between the driver and his fireman than there is between the driver and the second man today. When the steam engines went away and the diesels came, I put a stone in weight on within a year. So that just proves that although we didn't realise it at the time, we must have been working.
Welcome, Barnaby 2123. The RSIG Mallaig token now on display and request permission to proceed. Over. 2123, Roger out.
You start off at sea level and you end up at sea level in Mallaig, and it's just breathtaking. Every time we come round there, I just look at that scene and I just am amazed every time. I've been 40 years going up to Mallaig now and I never tire of it. Even yet, it takes my breath away. When we went to Mallaig, it was very common to have two or three fish specials a day. I think the record was 18 special trains in one day from Mallaig. And at that time, Mallaig was reckoned to be the busiest fishing port in Europe. It was just a hive of activity. There was two steam cranes on the pier unloading boats, loading wagons, and you could be more or less knee-deep in herring at that time. There was herring everywhere and seagulls by the thousand trying to steal them, you see. And when we used to go up there, of course, young, starving, you know, at 16, 17, you could eat anything. And the Mallaig kippers were lovely. And we very often got a couple of kippers and put them in a shovel and cook them. And they would cook in their own juice. Beautiful. Just, at that age, we could just about eat all the kippers in Mallaig, you know, and they were delicious. Well, it was always said that the new road, if they put a new road to Mallaig, that the railway was finished. It's a big project. In fact, there's people who think there's something more than just a road to Mallaig. There's talk of oil on the west coast, and whether there's any truth in that or not, I don't know. But some people seem to think that there's more in it than what meets the eye. We always feel that more should be invested in the railways. We feel the government put too much money into roads, and the railways always seem to come off worst. And when you see the money that's being invested in other European countries, we feel a bit jealous. The future for the Mallaig line was a bit doubtful a few years ago, but I think because of the steam engine, it's a bit better now, because every day it runs, there's about 350 passengers go to Mallaig. And I think it must have, it's bound to have helped the Mallaig line a lot. I can usually say that I've enjoyed my day's work, because I do enjoy my job. I'm maybe fortunate in that respect. I like my job, so many people don't. And when I come home, I like to leave the railway behind me and come home and maybe have a shower and go out fishing in my boat.
Hello there.
Hello there.
Have a good day.
Hi, you're bad.
Oh, it's lovely, nice, warm
lovely
now,
sunny
isn't it?
Day. Hello there.
If it's a nice day and maybe Helen's working, quite often I just go away and I spend the whole day in the boat. I take a flask with me and go away fishing all day. The dogs like coming out in the boat, and if I don't take them, they're inclined to go in the huff and they don't have anything to do with me when I come back. They're run down to it and they're jumping, trying to get into it. They're ready to go any time. I think they like fishing. They don't know what to do with them when they catch them, but they like fishing. There's nothing more peaceful than being away out in the boat, maybe 5 or 6 miles down the loch there, and nobody could get at you if they even wanted to. You're completely on your own. You're way down there, peaceful and quiet and beautiful scenery, and I don't think there's anything to beat it. I think I'll miss the railway when I retire. I think there'll be something wrong with anyone who worked in the railway all their days and didn't miss it. I probably will look forward to retiring because it will give me more time to do the things that the railway maybe spoilt when we were working there. But I'll certainly miss the railway, and I'll miss the men I work with, miss the companionship, and I'll miss the steam engine.